Well, the work I'm going to present is a pilot model that we are developing with Jonathan Barceló and Ivana González Bagur from CONICET CEMPAT and the University of Barcelona. This is a pilot model because one of the things that we start to do now is to test a kind of model that can be useful for ethnoarchaeological and to introduce ethnoarchaeological information. This work is motivated by the observation that when discussing how complex systems may provide knowledge useful for policy. And policy is one of the end of the aim of why we develop this model. How to use agent-based models in the context of ethnoarchaeological model? Two things we are wanting to link. The first one, archaeological data, historical data, how we introduce this data in a nation-based model. And the first question is to make and to propose an archaeological model. Is it really useful to use a nation-based model in the scale of research? And what can an archaeological model and historical model can offer? And then, if we want to design a participatory model, how can informants and the stakeholders be included in it? Who are them when we are thinking about informant or stakeholder? Modeler users, built an agent-based model is basically an interdisciplinary task. Potential developers, student, professionals, and also in the context of Patagonia, indigenous community and landholders. But I'm going to put in context what we are trying to develop this model. What is this exactly the context of the problem? First one, it is defined a problematic and conflict relationship between guanacos, is one of the camelids of Patagonia, and human. Guanacos, Olama guanicua, are regarded as injurious species because of their food competition with domestic livestock. This is where, I don't know if you see very well, but this is the distribution of guanacos in South America, but 75% of them are concentrated in two provinces of Argentina, Chubut and Santa Cruz. All the policy about this relationship is taken by the government as a problematic, but is defined especially without any scientific research, mainly with the defining as a problem as the producer. Producers are the ones who say that this is a problem. So the first question we say that is that true? Is that historical true or not? Because policy decision about hunting and approval by law and seasonal hunting is allowed with any kind of restrictions. All the ecological studies from ecologists as the Lamo, Saba, Baldi, define all the perception of the relationship between guanacos and people very heterogeneous, very different all around the territory. And this perception and attitude were related mainly with the economic productive activity that the main activity is sheep breeding. So, identifying this problem, as archaeologists, what are we are proposing? There's no scientific study. There are no long-term social approaches that have been assumed, or even all the historical and archaeological information is naturalized. People do policies, or apply policies, understanding that this relationship will always be in conflict. So, is that true or not? That's what, as historical and archaeologists, want to put in a critical aspect. So, the goals of our agent base is, first, develop a mechanistic model of guanaco hunting and fruit processing to analyze how each entity and activity is organized and changed. Here, the word mechanism is here a parable of how social intention, goal, and behaviors are casually connected. Then, three different platforms of simulation to explore how the model could work or be modified by informants of the stakeholders, and then evaluate which one fits better to this, the design of this archaeological survey. The questions driving the model constructions were the following: hunting as a social mechanism, should implement it procedurally, that is, algorithmically, and then how participatory decision making of Asian-based model of hunting and food processing will be affected according to informant and stakeholder decisions related with time, spaces, and frequency. So first, we don't want to make a model to predict something. We are trying to use Asian-based model to understand a problem. And also, we also want to use Asian-based model not to supply predictions. We are going to, from a decision-making perspective, what we want to do is reduce uncertainty. So, exactly what we have of data to build this model. First, archaeological information, and historical information, ethnographical information. All these are the input data that we are going to use. Archaeological information about the model of hunting is we are trying to develop a very mechanical Asian-based model. And in the historical information, we mainly take some information about historical explorers from the 19th century. And also ethnography, that ethnography coexists in Patagonia, and ethnography has been developed until the middle of 20th century. So, first things, we present in some previous CIAs our hunting and gather model. One of the first questions that we want to say or develop is it possible to use the previous model or which part of the previous model or not? So one of the, because it's also about hunting, but that about hunting and a group constitution. So first lesson that we learn, previous we use the tapas as take a previous model and add something, that doesn't result in us, because all models have limited transferability, but what we use was in reality a subprocess of the model that is only hunting. This is the base data of the model, and this is all the decisions that we take from the historical archaeological models. This is a typical, or this is a graphical model about how the decision makings of hunting are represented. So this is our simple model. This is what we design, a model that only have what happened in a day with a hunter and encounters a guanaco, and then what decisions they make, what they hunt, exactly what are the prey that they hunt. And then all the process of transformation, consume and discard of all of the parts of guanaco. Why we developed, and this is so schematical and simple way to develop this process, because one thing that we have in mind is that how we are going to explain it, or how we are going to introduce the stakeholder decision making in this model, and how they are going to perceive it. So the first platform that we use to explain the model is about flexing, that representing a chain of production. And this is very easily and to see it and to observe, and to observe the mechanisms and the moving on of all the process of when they hunt, they discard, they reuse, and they eat, or they transform the leader. In this case, the amount of guanacos that were at the origin of the model were defined, and also operators that work in this model are created according to the distribution that want to be tested. one operation, two operation, if the model is introduced some other agent as horses, etc. So I don't know if he's running here. No. Wait a minute. This is how Flexim runs. It's very simple and it's very easy to see all the variables and all and how exactly the model runs. So if we want to introduce or explain it with introducing some informants on the stakeholders, this is a very representative and a very easy way to show it. So the first definition and the first pros and cons about the using of this platform. First, it's very useful to represent production chains or processes with a high level of detail, because all the conditions and all the decisions are very easy to see and observe in the function of the model. Then it's very quick to, it's very easy to understand, mainly for users who don't need peer knowledge and on what they need to obtain when they want to obtain meaningful results. It's also very intuitive, but and the visual is very attractive too. But there are some difficulties or cons. That input parameters are not easily seen. The problems also have some problems with previous versions, and also with some previous 3D files. But if you want, it's easy to check or to test with the free version. We are not trying to say what exactly is the best or the worst platform to use. We are only trying to define that what platform, simulation platform, is very is useful for us in this case. Then the same process that we, this same process was designed in NetLogo. In NetLogo we also represent agents as hunters and guanacos. A time simulation in one day. What happened in one day when they find the resources? And I'm going to show you the program directly. Guanacos are activated each step, and then when the hunters have a radius of 5 kilometers here. You can see very well, but here is a radio action when the guanacos appear randomly. A group of hunters follow if they can see them. So they go out of the campsite. And you can follow the exact state of the hunters when they change the color, when they are trying to hunt, when they hunt, and when they are processing and bringing their things to the campsite. This is how we define the radio of what can they carry to when they hunt. Depends on the distance and depends on the weight, how much they can carry, and the doesn't work. Well. It doesn't work. I follow with the other. So what's a video? Pros and cons of the using this. First, the learning curve is fast. Starting from an example, you can easily develop a model. I think that many of us have the experience with the development of NetLogo, and NetLogo is very useful when you want to explain. It's very didactical also to introduce to some developers all the parts of the model, but the main problem of NetLogo is that you the impossible to modularize part of the program. So you write all the color together, and the result is very difficult to transfer part of the model or to modularize it. Also, it's very slow when you use a lot of agents. So the number of nations is significantly increased, the model becomes very slow. What we do with RedPass, the same. We design the same model and we use all the, trying to design the same case as NetLogo, the same process. Let's see if we can see it. Well, I don't know why I can see the, I can see the films. Well, I don't have the UCB because we checked it before, but no, doesn't run. Okay. Well, I want to use the video to show exactly what happened when they go out from the campsite, when they start to hunt. On all the variables that were introduced or not by the developers. So the pros and cons of RedPass, the development of the environment is friendly, using Eclipse, facilitates the code modularization, and allows applying good development practice and object-oriented program. It's useful to represent models at different scales, especially for complex and evolutionary models. The code is reusable. This is one of the most important things. But the cons is that it's not very intuitive also for people who are not related with simulation. And documentation is poor. That is another thing that is very important when you are designing a model. All the documentation that is free online to compare and to reuse or to discuss with another modelers. And documentation in RedPass was very difficult to find. The visual representation also is very similar to the representation in NetLogo models, but presents greater difficulty for the manipulation of space and agents. So these are the first conclusions. Because all we are designing and trying to use this model, but the first question is exactly what do we learn about the use of these three platforms? And is it really, is it useful for an ethnoarchaeological agent-based model? So first, one thing that we're discussed today, that the simulation mainly depends on the purpose of the research question. For our project objective, NetLogo results of it was most practical for our aim and objectives because it had better communication skill and interactive properties. But FlexSims also results very, very useful, mainly when you want to introduce stakeholder decisions. So exactly, what are they seeing? What are the decision making that they want to transfer us. So if you want to make some, introduce some ethnographical or some other point of view to the model, I think that FlexSim is better. And then this decision making process you can to implement in the logo if you want. If you want to introduce more agent, if you want to make more tests or more experimentation. Also, interactive models could facilitate knowledge transfer through discussion and feedback and diffuse point at different decision-making levels and between modelers, local researchers, and students. How do we link an ethnographical agent-based model as a tool to be used in policy decision-making? Historical models are also needed to assist policymakers in taking decisions while involving stakeholders to ensure a participatory planning process. We make a first pilot model. We try to we model with some people at our institute, mainly children and also researchers and also professors, school professors. Okay, it's the last one. And the problem is, of course, how we do communicate to people who are not have familiarity with all computer or computers, because people older than 40 in this case, even they didn't touch a mouse. But it's very difficult with children that in the moment they start to understand even the statistical results. So this is a very conflict that we are going to have if you are going to present these models in an indigenous community, in a school community in the inland of Patagonia, because how we are going to translate this image and this formalization in people that are very familiar with this this technology. So this is a fair experience that we have, but we have a lot of good experience for the other side with children. But people who are going to interview later are especially people who are from indigenous background. So, thank you very much.